Hello friends, welcome to the video lecture series on digital image processing. I am Dr. Alpesh Dafda, and in this 45th video class of DIP, we will study block transform coding in digital image processing and its implementation in MATLAB. Starting with the name, block means we will be subdividing our image into different smaller blocks. Transform means we will be transforming our image into other frequency domain from the spatial domain. And coding means we will be achieving compression. See, when we convert the image from spatial domain to frequency domain, we convert the spatial information into numeric data, or we can say frequency or spectra information, so that the image's information exists in a quantitative form that can be manipulated for compression. In our previous video class, we understood the differences between lossless compression and lossy compression. The techniques learned so far are lossless compression techniques, and now we will study lossy compression technique. So block transform coding is a lossy compression algorithm. And as the name suggests, for lossy compression, there will be loss of information, but the compression that will be achieved will be very large. So let us start. Starting with the block diagram of image compression model, which we studied in 37th video class of DIP, namely image compression model, because the block diagram of transform coding is similar to this block diagram. So you should refer to 37th video class first before understanding this video class. Here we studied that the encoder of image compression system consists of a mapper, a quantizer and a symbol coder, while the decoder consists of symbol decoder and the inverse mapper
and inverse quantizer
is not present because we know that quantization is irreversible. The transform coding is based on image transforms, for example, discrete Fourier transform, which we studied while studying image enhancement in the frequency domain. The term image transform usually refers to a class of unitary matrices used for representing images. Just as a signal can be represented by an orthogonal series of basis functions, an image can also be expanded in terms of discrete set of basis arrays called basis images. So what is a unitary matrix? In linear algebra, a matrix is unitary if its conjugate transpose is also its inverse. The lossless compression techniques which we learned till now operate directly on the pixels of an image, and so are spatial domain techniques. Whereas for transform coding, we modify the transform of an image. A reversible linear transform such as DCT or DFT is used to map the image into a set of transform coefficients. We know that DCT is discrete cosine transform and DFT is discrete Fourier transform, and DCT is preferred over DFT in image compression algorithms like JPEG because DCT is a real transform which results in a single real number per data point, in contrast to DFT which results in a complex number which has real and imaginary parts. So DFT requires double the memory for storage and processing power as compared to DCT, and therefore DCT is preferred for JPEG compression instead of DFT. So these transform coefficients are then quantized and coded, and the goal of transform coding is to decorrelate pixels and pack as much information into small number of transform coefficients so that compression can be achieved. So compression is achieved during quantization and not during the transform step.
So this figure shows the block diagram of a typical transform coding, and we already know this block diagram in this form, which we have already learned in 37th video class. The difference in this block diagram is that first we are constructing n cross n sub images from the input image m cross n, and finally we are merging them. So if this is our input image, then we are subdividing this image into n cross n sub images. So each sub image is n cross n, and usually it is 8 cross 8 pixels, and we are applying the transform to each of this sub-image. The decoder implements the inverse sequence of steps with the exception of quantization function of the encoder, which performs four relatively straightforward operations: sub-image decomposition, transformation, which is usually DCT, quantization, and coding. The goal of the transformation process is to decorrelate the pixels of each sub-image or to pack as much information as possible into smallest number of transform coefficients. The quantization stage then selectively eliminates or more coarsely quantizes the coefficients that carry the least information. These coefficients have the smallest impact on the reconstructed sub-image quality. The encoding process terminates by coding the quantized coefficients. Normally, using a variable length code such as Huffman coding, any or all of the transform encoding steps can be adapted to local image content called adaptive transform coding, or fixed for all sub-images called non-adaptive transform coding. This slide shows the procedure for transform coding. So for transform coding, any of the known transforms can be used, such as Fourier transform or Walz-Hadamard transform, but DCT is most optimal. So this DCT is used in JPEG compression that we'll be learning in the next video class. And the newer JPEG 2000 algorithm uses the wavelet transform, which we'll be learning in the next to next video class. So this method is effective because the frequency transform of images is very efficient at putting most of the information into relatively few coefficients. So many of the high frequency coefficients can be quantized to zero or can be eliminated completely. So main reason for mapping the original data into another mathematical space or transform is to pack the information into as few coefficients as possible. The simplest form of transform coding is achieved by filtering or eliminating some of the high frequency coefficients. However, this will not provide much compression, and so quantization and coding is applied to the reduced data. Quantization includes a process called bit allocation, which determines the number of bits to be used to code each coefficient based on its importance. So typically more bits are used for lower frequency components, where energy is concentrated for most of the images, as we know from the DFT or image enhancement in the frequency domain, resulting in a variable bit rate or non-uniform quantization and better resolution. So there are two particular types of transform coding: zonal coding and threshold coding, and these two vary in the method they use for selecting the transform coefficients to retain or to keep. So for zonal coding, we are using such zonal mask. So here these values will be retained in the output image, and this B shows zonal bit allocation, where we assign or allocate maximum bits towards this zone and very fewer bits to the out of the zone area. So this is a 8x8 sub image which we are forming in the very beginning. This C figure shows the threshold mask, and rather than using the zonal area to be retained, we are retaining values above some particular threshold. Therefore, it is known as threshold mask. So here it is shown that these all are the threshold values that will be retained, and the threshold coefficient ordering sequence is in the zigzag manner. As you can see here, it starts from 0, then 1, then 2. The explanation for zonal coding is shown in this slide, and threshold coding is shown in this slide. Let us implement block transform coding in MATLAB. So this is the MATLAB program for block transform coding using discrete cosine transform. And this example shows how to compress an image using DCT. The example computes the two-dimensional DCT of 8x8 blocks in an input image, discards or sets to zero all but 10 of 64 DCT coefficients in each block, and then reconstruct the image using the two-dimensional inverse DCT of each block. So here the zonal mask will be having or will be retaining 10 values out of the 64 DCT coefficients. So this DCT is used in the JPEG image compression algorithm. For typical images, many of the DCT coefficients have values close to zero, and these coefficients can be discarded without seriously affecting the quality of the reconstructed image. So let us run and see the output. So for this example, 85% of the values are discarded and only 15% of the values are retained in the compressed image, and still the quality of the compressed image is acceptable. So comparing the two images, we can see that this image is very sharp, and here the sharpness or clarity is gone at the cost of compression that is achieved. So that is all for this video class. In next video class, we will be learning JPEG image compression. Thank you very much.